Hello, everyone. God bless you. I pray that you are doing well today whenever you see this video. And I know that I need to do this video because the enemy has been just coming in so many different ways, trying to attack me from getting this word out. But yeah, we're going to get this word out. And I pray that this touches you. And I wanted to talk about religious narcissists, okay? And I just really believe that God delivered me from this religious narcissistic matrix, okay? Growing up, going to church, and just being indoctrinated through tradition, okay? Not through the spirit, not through real conversion, not through real love. Okay, I witnessed a lot of hypocrisy growing up, and that's something that, you witness growing up, especially in a lot of religious places that lacks the spirit. Okay, a lot of people who go to church, a lot of people who have been going to church for years, okay, everyone is not called to preach, everyone is not called to teach. God doesn't send everyone, and you can tell by how they, their fruit, okay, if they have the Spirit of God, all right, so... Yeah, so God has delivered me from this. So I really just want to reach out to those who have been experiencing narcissistic abuse through religion and through tradition. Okay. The devil operates in many different ways. And he loves using the church. I think that's his favorite thing to do. I mean, like, you're using the word of God to oppress people, or the people who are doing this, religious narcissists, right? They're using the word of God to oppress people and to hide their own sins and wicked deeds, okay? And it has to be called out. When Jesus addressed these people, he called them out. He did not play no games, okay? We're going to get into this word to just analyze and see how Jesus handled these religious people, religious narcissists, people who were full of pride, okay? They were not poor in spirit. They were not humble. They thought they were better than everyone else because of the knowledge that they knew. They were puffed up in knowledge and the law. But Jesus pointed out what was truly in their heart. And because he did that, they wanted to get him gone. They didn't want him around because he clearly shed light on their sin and on their wickedness and on their facade. And in order for them to keep that going, they had to get Jesus out the way. Like, nah, he too real. Like, nah, we don't, he not with us. You know, he's causing problems in the matrix. He's getting, you know, getting people to see past what's really going on. And they wanted him gone. So, yeah, we're going to dive into this word, okay? That is the standard for truth. That's why I'm using the word. There's nothing else that I'm going to ever be using except for the word of God when it comes to understanding what we should know and how we should live in wisdom for our lives and our experiences. Okay. So yeah. So the first Bible verse. Okay. Hold on 1 second. All right. So I'm back. Okay. So I got all my verses together. I wrote them down, but I wanted to make sure I had everything right and in order so I can go to it really quickly. Okay. And I just wanted to add that Jesus loved these people, okay? He loved them, and he wanted to show them where their pride was. and show them that this was separating them from God. Okay, so he strongly rebuked them and told them, just like how it was, he did not cover it up. He did not sugarcoat it. Okay, he didn't tiptoe around it. He told them what was in their hearts and that they needed to change because they were so haughty and prideful. Their hearts were so hardened that he had to really till that ground. It was very hard ground. So he was trying to break that ground down, you know. So, okay, we're going to go to Matthew chapter 23, verses 25 through 27. It says, "Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You clean the outside of the cup and dish, but inside they are full of greed and self-indulgence. Blind Pharisee, first clean the inside of the cup and dish, and then the outside also will be clean." Verse 27. "Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You are like whitewashed tombs, which look beautiful on the outside, but on the inside are full of the bones of the dead and everything unclean. In the same way, on the outside you appear to people as righteous, but on the inside you are full of hypocrisy and wickedness." Now this is Jesus speaking, and by the Holy Spirit, he knew what these people were about. Point blank, period. So he did not hold back. He told them like how it was. He strongly rebuked them. Okay, this was one instance in how he responded to them or how he dealt with them. Okay, you cannot play with the spirit. And I always tell you, you have to understand that we are in a spiritual war. Okay, and you're not playing and playing pat a cake with the enemy. Okay, and when it comes to our souls, you can't play with that. Okay, you don't take it lightly. You don't take it loosely. When someone is out of line like this, they need to be told the truth. Okay, if it's the right time, if it requires it. Okay, but we're just seeing. I just wanted to show you all how Jesus dealt with these people. Okay. All right. So that was the strong rebuke. Okay, now we're going to see another instance in how he dealt with the Pharisees. So let's go to Mark 3, 1 and 6. I'm sorry, 1 through 6. "Another time Jesus went into the synagogue, and a man with a shriveled hand was there. Some of them were looking for a reason to accuse Jesus, so they watched him closely to see if he would heal him on the Sabbath. Jesus said to the man with the shriveled hand, 'Stand up in front of everyone.' Then Jesus asked them, 'Which is lawful on the Sabbath, to do good or to do evil, to save life or to kill?' But they remained silent. He looked around at them in anger and deeply distressed at their stubborn hearts, said to the man, 'Stretch out your hand.' He stretched it out, and his hand was completely restored. Then the Pharisees went out and began to plot with the Herodians how they might kill Jesus." All right, so yeah, the Pharisees knew exactly what they were doing. That's another thing. This is how wicked and evil they were. Because when you operate in pride, pride will distort reality for you. Here, Jesus healed this man, and instead of being happy and celebrating and just being thankful to God that he was able to heal this man, they're upset because he's not keeping the Sabbath. Now, what sense does that make? Like, how heartless do you have to be to ignore the fact that this man who has been suffering is now healed? Like, they're looking at the fact that Jesus was healing on the Sabbath. Like, that's pride. Okay? That's something to rejoice over, to be glad about. That is a miracle. Right? But they're mad because he's not keeping the Sabbath, right? And after this, first of all, Jesus, you know, he called them out. Like, the truth is it, Is it better to do evil or to do good, to heal or not to heal on the Sabbath? Right? And because they couldn't reason with that because their hearts are wicked, instead of internalizing what he was saying and reflecting, they plotted on how they were going to kill him. So they were wicked, okay? They were wicked, plain and simple. They knew what they were doing. They saw that the man was healed. They didn't care about none of that, but they was trying, their hearts were set on evil, okay? Think about it. When you become saved and you're doing better and God is cleansing you from your unrighteousness, right? And you're not doing the same things you used to do. Look at who's happy about that. Look at who rejoices about that. They were more happy with this man being sick and unwell and suffering. They were completely fine with that. Right? But once Jesus healed him, they had something to say. So that's someone who heart isn't right, okay? And Jesus showed us in this verse, he showed us how wicked they were, because after this they plotted to kill Jesus for saving the man, okay? So just think about that. Okay, that's not someone you probably want to be around, okay? Because they're going to pull you back into your sin. They're going to pull you back into your oppression. And that is not the will of God. It was he who came and set the captives free. And anyone who wants to come against it, they're not of God. And these were religious people. They were supposed to be the most sanctified you could get. Okay? So, yeah. In this instance, Jesus used wisdom. The last example we've seen was he was rebuking them in Matthew, right? And in this example, Jesus was using wisdom. He was using wisdom, like trying to get them to understand, asking them a question to get them to internalize what he was saying. So that was another way Jesus dealt with these high time religious narcissists. Okay. So the last verse I wanted to go to is Luke chapter 20, verses 3 through 8. All right. But he answered and said to them, this is Jesus talking to the Pharisees because they were trying to catch him up in a lie, okay? So let's see. But he answered and said to them, I also will ask you one thing. They asked him a question. So he said, I will also ask you one thing and answer me. This was concerning the baptism. He says, the baptism of John, was it from heaven or from men? They were asking by what authority. Okay. They were asking Jesus, by what authority does he do what he does? Okay. So, yeah, let me go back. So, yeah, you have just read the whole chapter, okay? So, from verse 3 to 8, he says, but he answered and said to them, I will also ask you one thing and answer me. The baptism of John, was it from heaven or from men? And they reasoned among themselves, saying, if we say from heaven, he will say, why then do you not believe him? But if we say from men, all the people will stone us. For they are persuaded that John was a prophet. So they answered that they did not know where it was from. So it was all about the perception of the people, right? So that's all they cared about was their image. So verse 8, and Jesus said to them, neither will I tell you by what authority I do these things. And that's, yeah, so Jesus said, neither will I tell you by what authority I do these things. So he's like, he not even entertaining them. Okay. So, yeah, so that was one thing I just realized while reading. They were saying that people will stone us if they say the baptism was from men because they are persuaded that John the Baptist was a prophet. And that's how narcissistic people are. They are very insecure. So they want to change the perception of other people. They care about how people perceive them. Okay, that's how they are. And so they asked him a question. They asked Jesus, tell us, what authority are you doing these things? Or who is he who gave you this authority? And Jesus asked them a question. Okay, the baptism, who was it from? Was it from heaven or from men? And they were playing these mind games, right? Like they were trying to, they came with the intent to catch him up in a lie. And so they so tormented. They like, well, you know, if we say this, then they're going to say that. And if we say this, you know. So let's just, you know, they were very calculating in how they approached Jesus. So, and how they answered. So they weren't, they just were like, I don't know, you know, because they wanted to save face. And so Jesus wasn't going to play that game with them. And he was like, okay, well, I'm not going to tell you by what authority that I do the things I do. Simple as that. You know, so in this instance, he just didn't entertain them their games. I say all this to say is that when it comes to this narcissistic spirit, Jesus showed us how to deal with it. Because this is a very relentless spirit. It is a very wicked, hypocritical spirit. Okay, it's governed by the devil. It's very demonic. Okay, and we don't play patty cake with the devil. If anything, we have to speak the truth. If anything, we have to say what thus saith the Lord. Because that is the only way that this person who is choosing to operate this way will be saved. Okay, you can't play nice because they want weak-minded like Jezebel. There could be no Jezebel without Ahab. You get what I'm saying? So in order to deal with it the right way, in the way of true love, not this fake love, not this letting them get away with doing whatever they're doing, that's not love. Okay, in order to deal with this, you have to stand on the truth of God. You cannot waver. You cannot, you have to be strong. You have to be strong because this enemy, the person, the devil is using this person, or they're choosing to pull you back. Like it's a war for the soul. And they want to pull you back in darkness. They want to pull you back in sin. They want to pull you back into oppression and depression, to where you can't get out. Okay. This is a very, you can't play with it. Okay. You can't play with it. Okay. And Jesus showed us the way. He taught us how in his word. And that's why it's so important to have the Holy Spirit. Because if you don't have the Holy Spirit, the enemy can definitely use these people. It can be, especially if you were raised around these type of people, narcissistic people who are religious, you were raised to submit to that spirit, to succumb to that spirit. And the only way I was able to see it for what it was and to break free was through the Holy Spirit. That was the only way. That was the only way. And I got the Holy Spirit because I submitted my life to Christ. Okay. I was a sinner, and I was very, very deep in my sins. And I saw that it wasn't getting me anywhere. Living life my way, I was trying to get the things that I wanted in life, that I thought I wanted in life, my way. And it left me in a very dark and cold place. And I just had to make the decision to try God, to try His way. Okay? Because there was nothing I could do. There was nothing else for me to do, to pursue. I mean, my decisions left me in a very lonely, dark place. And I'm like, at that time, I was like, no, I can't keep going through the same cycles just to end up here. Like, that doesn't make sense to me. I'm suffering. I'm going through depression, you know, and I was running away from God. I didn't know why, but I felt like it would be too hard, or that He wouldn't be able to understand me, or that I was going to be miserable and lonely by myself. I really thought, just honestly, growing up in church, and we went to a very, like, y'all, this is a country church, okay? Like, it's in the middle of the country. Like, you cannot get there if you don't know where you're going. Okay. The Spirit of God wasn't in there. It was a Baptist church, and it wasn't that many members. It was just that my great grandparents used to go there. My mother continued to go there because that's where she grew up. And yeah, so we sung there. Like, if we weren't there to sing, then it most likely wouldn't be a choir there. Like, me, my siblings, my mom, you know, we sung in the choir. We made up most of the choir, you know. The congregation was very small, like very, very small, maybe like 15 to 20 people, okay? Like, on a regular Sunday, because we went first and third Sunday. So even then, like, if it was no program or anything, probably not that many, including us, maybe 10, 15 people. But it consisted mostly of older people. I feel like I'm going a little too long in this video, but it's okay. But yeah, it consisted mostly of older people, right? And it just seemed so dead. It was like, and being forced to go there, I did not desire to go at all. And we sang, and yeah, you know, and I would look at people who had been going there for years, like older people who had been going there for years, and I would see, like, they seem so miserable. You know, I'm like, man, so they've been going here all these years, and, you know, there was no fruit. You know, it just seemed like they just seemed like just miserable and bound to doing this all the time, or every Sunday, or however, to do whatever they did, whether it was a deacon or whomever it may have been. Like, I'm like, man, so they just been doing this for years, and they just look like, you know, just worn out, just tired. And I was like, I don't want to end up like that. Like, I was just like, just honestly, I was like, man, I know, you know. So doing what I wanted to do through sinning, or whatever the case might have been, whether it was sin or not, I was like, I felt like that was better. Like, I felt like I would be happier doing those things. But something God had to show me was that going to church is not having a relationship with Him. That's not necessarily having a relationship with Him. that was the first thing, first revelation I had. Like, you know, people forcing themselves to go to church, or, you know, they're doing this because this is just what we do. You know, it's religious. It's ritualistic. It's traditional. So that's what they do. So they would do it for that reason, not because they love God or not because they were operating in the spirit, you know. So that's a lot of the times why I ran away from God, because I just felt like, man, okay, I'm suffering and I'm going through this and I'm, you know, going through depression and I have this emptiness inside of me. So, you know, I hate that, you know, that's one side of it. And the other side is, if I come to God, then I got to be miserable for the rest of my life. And that's not true, you know. And that wasn't true. It was just what had been shown to me growing up as loving God, quote unquote, loving God. So I ran away. I was like, well, I don't want to do that either. I feel like I'm going to be even more miserable, you know. The devil definitely used that to get me to run away or to turn away from God, you know, to lack faith in him and how he could heal me and make me whole and make my life better, right? So I had been running away from God because of that. And, you know, I took a step out on faith and I was like, well, look, I don't want to keep living my life this way. When I made that declaration in my life that I wanted to do better, I wanted to be better. I knew I wanted a family and I didn't want my children to go through what I went through. And the only way that was going to happen was if I submitted to God. And if I submitted my ways to his ways, right? Because I wanted to get married too. You know, I grew up in a broken household. You know, my mother and my father got divorced when I was younger. So having that home of love and completion, you know, where both parents were there, you know, and it was a well-balanced home, you know, the mother's there, the father's there, and you get what you need from them. You don't go out in the world. I always thought I thought that I had to seek acceptance from others, from other people in the world, because I didn't have that at home. So I always thought that I wanted my children to know that they are loved. I wanted them to experience that and to know that they didn't have to go out into the world and get around a whole bunch of different people, especially people that they didn't need to be around, in order to get that acceptance. So I had that desire. I had that desire for a very long time, way before I got married. But that's what I desired. I desired to have a loving home. And that's what God gave me, you know. But that was only after I submitted to him, okay. And I decided to make him the head of my life. And I humbled myself and realized, okay, Lord, you know better for me. And that ever since that point, he led me every step of the way. And the first thing he did was allow me, well, one, he filled me with the spirit. I could feel the peace of God. It was like nothing I ever felt before. Nothing. You can't get it nowhere else. You can't get the spirit nowhere else. You know, it just is what it is. So when I willingly submitted myself to him, he gave me the peace of God. He gave me his Holy Spirit. And he began to show me things. And he showed me the the principality of narcissism that was around me. And it is a very heavy, territorial, controlling spirit. And if you don't have the Holy Spirit, you're not going to get out. Okay? And that was the only way he delivered me from that. And I was like, man, I can, it was like the spell had been broken, because when you are raised around this spirit, and narcissism, when you're raised in it, it's like you're completely brainwashed from a child. Like, it's like evil communication corrupts good manners. Be not deceived. Evil communication corrupts good manners. So when you are, especially when you are raised around this spirit, you see life the way they tell you to see it, out of that lens of perversion and wickedness and darkness. You know, this had a very strong hold on me spiritually. Okay, you need the Holy Spirit. It's not just to tell you that you're wrong about everything. You know, people misconstrue God with him being a dictator. Absolutely not. The Holy Spirit comes to bring you joy, peace, love, patience, faithfulness. Okay, these are things that you cannot get anywhere else. Okay, and it gives you wisdom, discernment. And we need wisdom and discernment, okay? And because I was so brainwashed, if you will, and raised a certain way to think a certain way, I could not see things the way that were true. It's like evil is good and good is evil. The Holy Spirit will teach you how to deal with this spirit. When Jesus dealt with this spirit, he did not play. He did not play any games with them. He told them straight like it was. Okay? And he didn't play patty cake with them. Okay? If they reject the love of God, the truth of God, then there's nothing you can do. Because they're going to reject you too. So, you got to stand on the side of righteousness. Okay, which is what Jesus taught us to do, even when facing these people. All right, so I love you, and until next time, bye-bye.